stop with me tonight. And got any apologies for absence? I've got Councillor Richard Jones and deputising his councillor.
We have no name.
So any more apologies? Okay, so any declarations of interest?
Mr Chair, non-definition interest on item 5, Sagenta is part of the plan change programme. And I don't believe it. Please be taken part.
Okay, thank you. And nobody's bound by anybody. So, thank you. Because of what's going to be discussed in notice of motion on item 4, I'm proposing that we move item 4 to after item 6. So, a lot of what's going to be discussed in item 6 will cover off that notice of motion. Stay at the rate. That much motion is open. I'm good with that.
Appreciate that in London, notably more council in the business region, also an excellent public health documentation, quote from that later, performs Wellington. Other councils, Portsmouth, had recently, only 6 months ago, passed a very similar notice of motion. We indebted to Portsmouth City Council for the fact that we were aware of the notice of motion I moved. It's actually where for where they asked their officers to do a piece of work to look at how they could include this in their plan via a supplementary planning document. Manchester City Council in October of last year did the same thing. They asked their officers to explore the possibility of requiring property developers, building houses in Manchester, to publish financial viability assessments to encourage the building of more affordable housing. The difference, Chair, with Rivers, we can't actually do this overnight. I'm advised, legal advice tells us that we need in place a local plan to be able to take this forward. And your committee will be aware, because we've had presentations over the last couple of months, that our local plan timetable, I think, runs to 2020, 2021 before we're able to adopt that. So I understand that time is on our side, or certain time is on the side of this committee, in considering the way that we, hopefully, the way that you would like to address the issue, given that it seems to be the way a number of councils are tackling the issue of economic viability assessments and developers attempting to circumvent it. I mean, if we flag up now that this is the direction of motion that we'll get to the direction that we're going in, and by 2021 we will require that, the pressure will be actually on land value. The price, the reason that developments become unviable in the eyes of the developer, or is like front-loaded, is because they pay too much for the land. Building costs are a fixed piece at the end of the day. You pay your labour, you pay your house, depending on the size of the house you want to build, they are fixed. The thing that makes a lot of these things viable is the price that pays for them. And that's why a lot of the housing is expensive. You know, that's one of the housing plans that we've got. Broadly, regardless, developers pay too much for that. If we say early doors, we are going to require these things to be published. If developers don't want them published, then they need to ensure that the viability, that the price that they pay for that, makes the development viable from the beginning. Just on the subject of affordable housing, our policies, and our policies under the report are already in place this couple of weeks. Last year the Council commissioned the housing market appraisal to inform our calculations of how many houses we would need to build and what they would, etc. That concluded in various paragraphs, that we had a requirements across the world of 40%, or 40% of all developments in the next 5 years should be affordable housing. So that was made by an independent consultant calling the rating analysis. And I hope officers would like to answer questions and back up the figures. In the local plan, we accept that there will be viability issues for developers meeting the 40% target. We accept from day one, we can't possibly ask them to make 40% provision of affordable housing and development because it wouldn't be valid. So in the local plan, we already have reduced requirements of affordable housing of 10 and 20%, respectively, depending on whether it's an area of high demand and therefore low viability, or one of low demand and therefore high viability, if members follow. So the issue of viability has already been addressed by this council in its policies. Our independent assessment says it should be 40%, but we are hoping to get away with between 10 and 20% because we already accept that 40% would not make developments viable. But then to come back and say we still can't do that, stretching is unreasonable, and if they generally can't do it, there is no reason whatsoever why we can't make all of that information public. Manchester going down that route knows we already required publication, one of the councils required publication, Portsmouth is already going down that route. My request to this committee is to signal that we wish to go down that route, engage officers to look at what's happening in other councils and what the councils currently do, and get ourselves a bespoke policy ready for inclusion in local and municipal business expenses.
Thank you, Councillor Cameron. Now, Mr. Thorburn, Thorburn speakers, if you want to speak to that, speak.
Yeah, I don't think there's much argument that this is an area that we need to get better and look at a bit more closely. The difficulty I have in the, I won't be hurt by all arguments about the notice of motion as a method of getting things to committee. It is here, and I don't personally believe I've got enough information to my hand to say whether this is the way forward, and meet more involved officers and other elected members, and possibly some information from these other authorities to see where it goes. But it's not. The problem with these policies is that not one size will fit all. The issues about affordability in the north and affordability in the south are greatly different, and so a lot of these sort of guidelines are basically national guidelines. The other position I've got a difficulty with is about competitiveness, because sometimes you are competing, not particularly in the affordable housing, you are competing for investment in areas. And we've seen some really good recent examples of where the affordable housing model simply would have broken the viability model. We sat in only the nightmare's room where we did not ask for any affordable housing on these St. Anselm's application because of the viability of the new meeting St. Anselm's. So it also has to fit in with our wider strategy of actually, it sounds awful this, but we recognise one of our funding issues is that the vast majority of our properties sit within the band A and B category. And we need to have better income from council tax, more higher banded properties. I know it sounds a little bit strange from a Labour councillor saying that, but that's the reality. That's the reality of why some of the mechanisms have always worked against us. So it's a very complicated issue, I think I'm trying to say, Chair. A very, very complicated issue. But I think we agree where we can, and where we have a policy that allows us to be have some flexibility, that seems to suit for that application. We're always told each application stands on its own merits and its own right when it comes to committee, that we need to. So I'd say, I couldn't, hand on heart, Stuart, I couldn't say, yeah, I'll have all of this. I might want some of it, I might want the direction of travel, but I think we need to, I hope someone proposes that it needs a little bit more of a look at before we leave in with both feet. And that's the type of thing I'm sort of thinking at the moment. That's helpful, Chair.
Thanks, Chair. I think the world's turned upside down, where I'm going to argue against developers and say that developers shouldn't be shirking the responsibilities, when we have to build affordable housing. I understand Steve's point about wants to get money in from damaged properties or whatever else wants to build on standards, on golf courses potentially. But other than that, I think we do have to address affordable housing. It's a big issue that we need to have housing across the UK. And this is one of the mechanisms by which we can make sure that we have affordable housing in the world. So I mean, take the point. And I'm quite happy to, I think Steve's got a good point, but it's a big thing to just read into on a yes and no. There's a motion going on to the back of the committee, maybe we can look at it in more detail, that's a way forward, but yes. You know, we can just kick it into the long grass and then ignore it, so yeah, I agree on the second one.
Thanks, I've got Andrew Ian and there's a proposal from Chris.
Me first, just to be brief, I agree with Steve, I agree with Adam. I think the problem we've got, and everyone knows this, we do need a full how do we look at the problem to entice developers to build affordable housing? We have to put something in place because we all know developers are there to make a profit. The best way to make a profit is to build a big house. And we've got to put something in place whereby we look at the situation to see what happens to entice developers to spend money on affordable housing.
Thank you.
not possible for us to do this prior to having a local plan. Could I ask for some legal advice? Why is that? I'm curious as to why we want a local plan before we can adopt a policy of having economic viability assessments to work.
This is probably not legal advice, but in terms of these issues, the really important across Wimbledon, as members already recognised, my view would be I think that more work is needed so that you're fully informed in terms of taking a view. Now, we do have affordable housing policies already set out, as you know, in the Jewish Development Plan. I think, I'm not sure it's a policy issue if you decided to make certain liability assessments public where they affect affordable housing, because that's just a public decision that the council can take if it wishes to do that, and that's in line with the policy. Yes, yeah, I mean, that is the issue, and why the liability assessments at times are confidential is because of the commercial aspects of them. But I understand Councillor Kelly's motion correctly, is looking at specifically the area of affordable housing. What you might just need to think about also in viability assessments on other aspects of schemes as well. So maybe it's something just worthy of further investigation. But if you decided to do that on affordable housing, I don't think that that is an issue. I don't think it's tied into necessarily that to do with the local plan.
I think this sorry, through the chair, this is an issue which has been addressed, I think, by lawyers within the section, and I think there's been an email communication to Councillor Kelly about this. I think the regulations, as worded, need to be talking about affordable housing as an issue, considering that an option, how you go forward with that, that would normally feed itself into a local plan. Regulations, planning regulations, which confirm that.
I'm not quite clear in terms of the answers that we've heard from the officers who have outlined. Are we saying that we are not able to complete the viability assessments now, or we have to wait until there's a legal plan in place? I'm not clear from the answers that you've both given.
The issue with the local plan is that if you have any burden, if it affects to classify them, developers, it has to be set out in a local plan and go through a statutory process. So the requirements would have to be set out in the local plan. Currently, the council's UDP encourages affordable housing and doesn't require it, so it makes it a matter of negotiation rather than requirement. Your strategy will turn that into a requirement and you'll then set out a number of parameters which the publication of the viability assessments could be included. Currently, we require viability assessments to get out of the if developers can't develop their site and provide affordable housing viably, we allow them to submit a viability assessment. Currently, that's confidential. We have it tested by an independent appraiser, and that's then the result of their report to the planning committee. But the appraisal itself is not published, and that is because of the commercial confidentiality aspect. And I think in other cases, we do sometimes publish some parts of documents that are not confidential and parts that hold back, parts that are. That may be one approach. But if we start making requirements on developers and tying them down to it has to be done a local plan first.
Thanks. I'm thinking about the last planning committee that I accept Councillor Fowler's point about he has a keener interest in the going to home spend what about to ask about okay, we have heard an application for the going to homes for property in West Kirby where there was no affordable housing provided on the site. Would we have asked for a viability assessment as part of that application?
I didn't know how to begin with that. I didn't know where this bait was going. I declared interest at the bank, so I've been here.
Just answer
the question to the chair. I think the issue in that application was that we didn't provide one. And that was the issue in the question.
Could I, one last point. Could we then, as a policy, I've said what the officers say, could we not have, as a policy,
within every planning application, could it say if a liability assessment has been undertaken? That would assist us in terms of, as a planning committee, knowing the background to it, and we'd then have to have a further discussion or, you know, request the documents or whatever, but it would be useful as a committee to know if there had been a liability assessment undertaken, so that we're not then disputing the further from the developer with no evidence to support or oppose their position.
Yes, we can do that. I mean, normally, whenever there's a liability assessment on any planning application, that is reported to planning committee.
But it doesn't say.
So, does that mean that if you don't ask for it, you don't get it? Which isn't very satisfactory, is it?
He is asking for it, so that's what.
So, we're now saying it has to be as a standard thing?
We only require a viability assessment, and we do require one where the developer is not going to meet our published target of 20% or 10%. Wherever they go below that, they must put in the viability assessment, and that is reported to the committee, planning committee, before it is undertaken to approve or otherwise that application.
Okay, I think we've delayed on that one. It's straying more into planning than the environment. So, can someone bring Steve back in, please?
Based on local influence, that's against effectively what you pay for a mortgage. So there were some calculations there, and it's all, there's also affordable rent calculated as well, which I think on the back of the line, if you pay more than, have to pay more than 35% of your income on housing costs, above that is the affordable rate if you like.
So can I propose that we take this to a task and finish with the chair?
Okay, I've got two more speakers that want to join in for timing. Yeah, just on the question of affordability, I would have thought that would be an intrinsic part of what the task and finish group would look at.
But it must already exist, so what we do with it.
We'll look at it,
Magenta.
There's only reasons for that.
I think it's been suggested that lots of the buildings don't be moved, that it goes to a task and finish, and I support that. Yeah. I think if nothing else, the whole discussion tonight has actually proved that is probably the only way forward. I don't think we're all exactly clear as to what the way forward is on this. I think we need to take it to a task and finish, do some more work, and then if it needs to go to Canberra, we can come back here and sub it. So I support the proposal for a task and finish.
Just to add to the confusion, you wrote planning issues. We had more than one application of planning that had a met the affordable housing criteria. We refused it on the ground. We went to the inspector for appeal, and he said there was no requirement for affordable housing. So we lost. You know, so there is a lot of confusion out there about what is right.
So, task and finish group. Okay, so we're back to proposal for task and finish group. Okay,
I've got an
agreement.
Yeah.
I'll give you an opportunity to come back
to
that as well.
There's just three points of criticism that I bristled at, Chair, which I'm glad Steve's not here. I have to do a notice of motion, that's what the Constitution says. If you have an idea, then you've got to do a notice of motion. I certainly accept that it's a complex issue, and I did make the point because of the legal advice that I've had, I did feel that we had bags of time to bring a smaller group of members up to speed and knowledgeable on the matter. And also, because I want to know how Portsmouth are getting on, I want to know how Manchester are doing it, I want to know how those are getting away with it. So far with some of the legal advice that I initially got. It is worth pointing out that initially the officer said, "God, this is commercial confidentiality." That was the default position of the legal department. It's only after showing the legal department, Portsmouth did it, that the advice got slightly more nuanced, with the best way to allow for the legal department. So yes, everybody, members, officers, and everybody, need to get themselves up to speed, I would suggest, and that might be the best way forward. And finally, Chair, for now, just because we're requiring the publication of what doesn't mean that the planning committee would then, ignore the evidence. So, for example, if a developer comes forward and says, "I can't put any affordable housing on this site for X, Y, and Z reason," publishes the viability assessment that demonstrates it. If that is to the satisfaction then of the planning committee, then clearly they will allow the application without a fund. The point is, the whole process becomes more open and transparent, and I think that's where Portsmouth want to be, it's where Manchester want to be, and it's where Moseley is.
Okay, thank you. We'll have that to the
Thanks, Chair. Good evening, Deputy. Good morning. Good morning.
ability, the liaison officer for the council to meet, advise the I just want to receive our report this evening. All we're going to do is we're going to deliver an PowerPoint presentation. That helps you oversee the report. In impact, there's a report, an annual review, and an action plan. And what we're looking to do is following your comments and your endorsement, you want to forward it to the cabinet member. Because that underlines our commitment to the local one, which I'll explain. So, over to Mark. Slide on to the right.
Delighted to be here. Thank you for letting me out for once a year to speak and you'll enjoy the presentation. My task is to illuminate the report you've got. I mainly going to talk about what we can do about climate change, so the actions, rather than talk about climate change itself. But I do want to say three things. So, firstly, our lives are shaped by the climate, so it's a big deal if the climate changes. Most of human history has been relatively stable, so when things start to change, all sorts of things change, the patterns of agriculture, the way we live, and so on and so forth, so it's a big deal. Secondly, we're living through it. It's already happening. It's already happening, and more is going to happen from the historical pollution that's already there. So globally, the race is on to stabilise those emissions and cut the emissions and stabilise the global temperature rise. So at the international level, the UN are trying to limit the rise in global average temperature to 2 degrees compared to pre-industrial levels. But they have an aspiration that it be limited to 1.5 degrees. So the next point is, and it's related to that, small changes in temperature when it's a global average makes a big difference. So if you imagine a distribution around that average, some days it's hot, some days it's cold, and the average is the most frequent. So when the average moves, shown here as a shift up to the right, the extremes are what we look at. So there's a lot more what used to be relatively rare extreme temperatures. Suddenly there's a lot more of it. So when we talk about temperature, we're not thinking about day to day, minute to minute. If you go out today, it's pretty cold. Tomorrow it might be hot, but we're talking about global averages, and that has a massive consequence for us all. So you don't need to know this because you've already set a political commitment to act on climate change, and this is a very long-standing one. First, the council signed up to the Nottingham Declaration on Climate Change, and that led to the first rural climate change strategy, and more recently, council signed up to Climate Local and LGA initiative, and that was the successor sort of programme to the Nottingham Declaration, and that's effectively led to what we're going to be talking about progress with. So the climate change strategy, so that commitment to Climate Local has led to the climate change group to a process, consultations and so on, developing the climate change strategy, and now trying to make sure it's implemented. So this is like the central point of reference really to everything we're talking about. So the strategy itself, the two goals, reducing climate pollution, adapting to unavoidable change. Six aims under that, one of which cross-cuts both, which is building capacity for action. So point of interest, there's 77 objectives in the strategy. So there's plenty of material covering loads of different areas. So the one thing that Climate Change Group has done, which is a broad partnership of different organisations, has put together a rolling action plan. And it's identified 200 actions so far in the first 3 years. About half of those have been completed. The group has also produced three annual reports called STEPS. One of which is one of the documents in the appendices that might refer to. So that's the kind of background that this time, 3 years in, the group taxes looked a bit more in more detail. So 3 years in, where we are, what's been achieved, where are the sort of areas where we need to perhaps do more, with a view to focusing on the remaining 2 years and trying to make the biggest impact possible. So I'm just going to run through under each of the main aims which I outlined in that visual diagram, telling you some of the things that have happened and some of the areas where there are perhaps some things that haven't happened as well as we might have hoped. So on the energy efficiency side, there's been big progress on LED streetlights. There's been major investments in the NHS estate, new combined heat power, 5.6 million spent with the Royal University Teaching Hospital and NHS Trust. But in other areas, interesting to that panel before, so we haven't perhaps made as much progress on home energy efficiency as we'd hoped. There has been great strides taken a few years ago, but the amount of money that the utility companies that are obliged to put into energy efficiency has been reduced and is now more targeted. There's also been some delays in the development planning process, land use plan, which make it more difficult to stipulate higher energy efficiency standards from particular developments. We have yet to find a source of funding for driving energy efficiency improvements in community buildings. We made some links to the rollout of smart meters. I've seen the adverts for those, which are a potential great opportunity to get people thinking about energy efficiency. But I'd say that the opportunity has not been as great as we'd hoped at the outset. I think that nationally they've accepted and perhaps moving it a bit more towards pushing the energy efficiency aspect. And certainly one of our partners, Energy Projects Plus, has got some funding towards promoting smart meters, and through that they're able to engage people with issues around how people can save money and save energy. On the renewable energy side, we have a Centre of Excellence for Offshore Renewable Energy, in the city region. Doesn't need much explanation on that one. There's also a new community benefit society, Rural Community Renewables, that's been established to pool local resources for investment in renewable energy schemes. That group's appointed consultants who are looking at potential sites for solar development, and that work ended up featuring a national study about the possibility of solar energy, community owned solar energy, supplying the electrified rail network. So there's also the Collective Switch, a programme which is promoted across the city region. We've made sure that there's a renewable energy option, the Collective Switch options, which is objective in the strategy. In other areas, less progress, the strategy talks about a small scale onshore wind trial, but this is changes in land use planning policy at the national level has really kind of stopped that, in the sense that there's now sort of like a land use plan before you can really progress onshore wind turbines. Also, there's been a change in the incentive rates for micro renewables. This is just a diagram which is in one of the reports in the appendices. The installation rates in the months leading up to when the fixed rate, the feed-in tariff rate dropped. So we can see a great drop, a spike and then a drop off. There are still incentives, so they're still there, they were just less. So there'll probably be another spike when they do away with them completely in I think the next year. So it's just changed the finance and the modelling, so schemes which perhaps could have been viable but then kind of put back on the back burner. So the council itself is installed just over half a megawatt across 24 locations, and that they were all done at the attractive sort of incentive rate. In sustainable travel, we've got progress with secure cycle parking at all bar one of the Merseyrail electric stations. There's been the cycle map produced, which is in the strategy. There's also been developments to the cycle network, new charging infrastructure for electric vehicles, three sites established at Seacombe Ferry Circle, Birkenhead North, and Elgin Way car parks. Perhaps more of a mixed picture on the bus front and the integration. Walrus cars, smart cars, it's one of the biggest schemes, I believe, outside of London. It has extra ticketing products on it, but perhaps whether it's fully yet integrated, I'm not really convinced myself, but it's moving forward. I think here is where the context has also changed. So there's now the devolution, the city region work and transport, and the possibilities of developing a kind of regional smart car and those sorts of things. So that may help improve things. Some local programmes that support sustainable transport choices have reached the end of their funding period. So we've had business travel support and living streets and actively doing various work with schools and communities on walking routes and so on. The funding for that's now run out, so they're not no longer in place. If you consider indirect impacts, this is a bit of a mix sort of bias. So just think about where our decisions have implications. So the type of food we eat has implications for the amount of emissions through agriculture and so on. On the food side, we've got Better Food We're All established as a brand for these sorts of discussions. There's also been work on meat-free menus in local schools through eco-schools. So we're talking about the environmental impacts of large-scale meat consumption. One of the things is local trade as well as part of an indirect impact, so local supply chains. Here the chamber are obviously active in encouraging local intertrading. For example, there of a recent supplier event for the construction sector. On the waste side, numerous organisations have now adopted Walkit, which is this portal whereby organisations can offer surplus items that are no longer needed to be claimed elsewhere within the organisation. Not claimed within the organisation, they can be claimed by another organisation linked to that support system. So started with Cheshire and Rural Partnership NHS Trust, we've now got a walking portal at the council. Walking portal is available to all local schools, and walking portal is available to community and voluntary sector organisations through Community Action Rural. We've got the waste strategy, but recycling rates aren't stalled, things aren't going the right direction there, so, and that's something that's not local, it's a local thing, so that it's not all moving in the right direction. I put decisions on this one, I didn't know where to, I didn't have a picture to put on this one. This is about, we talked about promoting sustainability appraisal in the strategy. This is really somewhere that's not been very well developed, but I think it's a key thing, it's something that we perhaps need to think about going forward. Is the climate change group isn't a decision-taking body, it doesn't make big strategic decisions, so to speak. Council obviously does. So the question of how can we factor in these sorts of issues into those decisions so that we are making kind of future-proof decisions, decisions that both reflect what the climate's going to be like over the long term, but also anticipate sort of change to a low carbon economy that's been set out by governments. On the climate adaptation side, mixed bag here, we've got rural resilient parks project. We've got the local climate impact profile that's been renewed, getting ahead of myself.